And how soon can we actually expect the ICC to come out with a more updated decision or at least resolution that already somehow covers what has been discussed in public sphere?
Well, the ICC works really slow, to be frank, because it's very meticulous with its evidence gathering, evidence tagging. Every piece of information, every piece of paper is numbered, analyzed, vetted. And I would say that right now they are already cognizant of what's happening before the Quadcom. It would just be a matter of time before they get the official records and authenticated records. By the end of the year, I'm looking at further developments because the end of the year is a time when they reconfigure things out and see where their investigations should take them in the next year. But independent of that, one key development would be the issuance, possibly, of a warrant against the most responsible persons. We've heard about the summons already issued against five top officials. We're very much looking forward to issuance of a warrant of arrest and eventual enforcement so that trial can ensue. The thing with trial is that when it begins, that's the time when officially victims or witnesses can come in as participants in the trial. And that's a time, that's a signal for possible protection mechanisms to kick in.
And just to clarify, these particular warrants that you are expecting, are they part of the so-called further developments that you hope to happen by year end?
Well, they are related to earlier announcements and earlier developments. But again, the ICC works really meticulously. So I'm hoping before the end of the year, there could be issuances, not only because of Rowena Garma's statements, but because of strong evidence already held by the ICC.
Right. But would you say at least that the ICC can somehow wrap up its investigations before the dawn of 2028, when possibly another Duterte will rise into power?
Well, with that long a period, yes, I would hope that we start trial before 2028. And that's crucial in a sense, because that could also be a time that Sara Duterte, one of those who comes under the scope of the investigation, could become president. That's a very likely scenario. And for the ICC, it would be an important factor in considering interests of justice, whether pursuing the investigation and trial would be in the interests of justice, meaning would it cause more harm in the Philippines if it continues with the trial or not.
Mm-hmm. Christina, another point here. Former President Rodrigo Duterte has filed a certificate of candidacy for Davao City Mayor. How does that actually complicate or affect the fact-finding probe of the ICC?
I would say that it affects the implementation or execution of a warrant. Local chief executive exercises some degree of control over local police. And within that context, we've seen how the Davao arrest of
Apollo Quiloy,
was enforced. And so we're looking at different scenarios, similar scenarios as to that. If one of those who are to be arrested is the Davao City Mayor, then it will really pose complications. And hopefully it won't, hopefully one of those scenarios, well, one of those scenarios already is, or several of those scenarios would be violent scenarios. Hopefully, we won't get there to those violent scenarios.
Right. And to be fair, still no guarantee that he would actually win the mayoralty elections in Davao City, considering that another Nograles will be running against him. But let's talk about the frailty that the former president seems to be displaying right now. Would you say that that would also affect a possible arrest against the former chief executive?
For the ICC, age and, well, health condition is only a matter for consideration as regards detention conditions and not whether he or she should be arrested. On another point, he or any arrested person, given health consideration and age considerations, could also apply for what we call bail, for release, temporary release, and this would be significant factors. But I think what would be very significant for the ICC is the certainty of this person facing trial, that this person will not flee and will not evade the hands of justice, so-called. So I would, you know, say that it would be safer for Duterte if he volunteers himself, in case there is a warrant of arrest, to go to The Hague. And it would be less taxing on him to go to court if he was detained somewhere close by.
Are you actually even hopeful that that is a plausible scenario given the personality of the former president?
Well, of course, if you have to lay down the scenarios, you lay down everything from the worst to the best. And I guess that would be the best scenario. He comes forward, says that. That's also part of his personality, though, no? For him to accept responsibility that he is willing to accept. So sometimes we've heard him say, extrajudicial killings, yan lang ang kasalanan ko. Akong bahala sa inyo kapag winapatay kayo. Hopefully, he considers that as well, that for him, accountability is an integral part of our democratic system and of his personality as well.
I have to be very honest, that's a very optimistic point of view. And speaking of optimism, tell me about your thoughts with regard to the PNP deciding to revisit some drug-related cases following the recent revelations from the House Quadcom hearings.
Well, you know, for the victims, all we have is hope. As to the PNP investigations, of course, we very much welcome these investigations, though long overdue. Imagine it's 2024. These killings started 8 years ago. And if it needed this, what was the impetus for these kinds of investigations? It was essentially, we're saying that these are all politically motivated. We need the Dutertes and the Marcoses needed to publicly break up before these investigations could continue. For the PNP, it doesn't do well to indicate sincerity in the investigations, because otherwise, if they were sincere, they would have started this as early as before. Although we understand that the witnesses are just coming forward today, I mean, come on, with their investigative prowess, perhaps they would have made better headway closer to the time of the killings. And this does not bode well, actually. This kind of belated investigation does not bode well for other victims of the war on drugs. There are many of those whose kin were killed in vigilante killings. And in these cases, how would we identify the killers? The CCTV footage would be erased already. The witnesses would maybe have relocated already. So hopefully we get the same kind of treatment for all and for the thousands others of killings.
Right. I can't help but mention that Kian De Los Santos, the unfortunate poster boy for the EJK, or the extrajudicial killings under the Duterte administration, would have turned 27 by now. He was 17 when he was killed. That's how long it took already.
Yes, I know. And for many of the victims, they have children, or they had children. And one of these children now, who was months old by the time his father died, is around 7 years old, I think, in elementary school already, and asking, what really happened? So it's been very heartbreaking for many of these families how to explain what really happened. But for this particular kid, he wasn't able to get into the courtroom, but he was able to attend the conviction hearing of the four Caloocan City policemen who killed his father, Gabriel Luis Bonifacio.
Mm-hmm. And Christina, what are legal counsels of these families actually doing to further push the current administration to hasten the proceedings?
Well, proceedings first before that. Domestic courts and domestic tribunals, because frankly, we have no more cases to file before domestic courts because of the lack of evidence, even with this renewed interest in the EJ case. In the Quad Committee, what we can do is just present our stories, try to put to fore particular areas and flag particular areas with where the drug war killings were hotspots in the drug war killings. For example, Caloocan, bring that to fore again, Bulacan, and Cebu. In the ICC, it would take a little bit more of prodding. Actually, we've already submitted a lot of information and many documents to the ICC. And hopefully they can look into the connections already. So for us, actually, it's no longer, before the ICC, it's no longer about the individual incidents. This is about the pattern of killings. This is about widespread and systematic killings, which we could all pin down, not only to the ones who, you know, pulled the trigger, but to the ones who ordered them. And that would be Rodrigo Duterte.
Mm-hmm. And Christina, it wouldn't be far-fetched to think that interest would eventually die down with regard to the House Quadcom hearings, considering that we are entering an election cycle once lawmakers there begin their campaigns in their districts or even nationwide for party-list representatives. They wouldn't have enough quorum to actually proceed with the House Quadcom investigations. What then would you ask lawmakers to prioritize at this point? And what is the ideal timeline for the Quadcom to eventually wrap up its investigations?
Well, I wouldn't want to put a time frame on the Quadcom hearings. In fact, we've heard the chairman talk about continuing investigation even until the next Congress. Well, that is on the premise that they were to be re-elected. But at the least, as an exercise in due diligence, the Quadcom hearings or even hearings before the House Committee on Human Rights, that's where we first started bringing in the victims for their testimonies. That's crucial for us because, as it turns out, I mean, the witnesses aren't coming forward in all at the same time. So we won't expect them even today. Today would have been another session for the Quadcom, but it was actually postponed. So even right now, not many witnesses are coming forward. So we would want to make it as comprehensive as possible. But to be fair for the victims, hopefully they wrap up within or alongside the framework of the ICC. For the victims, we actually are looking at the ICC, an international investigation, to be more circumspect in the investigation because they would be remote, they would be distanced from political developments. They would not be affected. Of course, they would not be up for elections by 2025 or 2028. They should not be affected by any political developments, except that, I mean, as to the substance of the investigation. But yeah, for the ICC, we would just like to cooperate further. And in case a trial begins, unlike the Quadcom, this would be a judicial investigation and judicial proceedings. Hopefully that's where Duterte and all the other respondents would get the due process that they have denied our victims in the first place.
And here's to hoping that we will see some fruits of labor from the ICC by year end. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, ICC Assistant to Counsel Attorney Christina Conti.
Thank you, Katrina. Ingat.